Electronic ballast, e-ballast, digital ballast, they're all one and the same thing. Crafty metal boxes that transform your regular electrical supply into something that will strike and run an HID grow light. Here are 8 things to consider before you buy. Number 1, input voltage. Most e-ballasts will accept a range of input voltages, typically between 105 and 255 volts. Some will take up to 285. Sun system ballasts call this feature smart volt. Just be sure that your chosen ballast will run with your input voltage. Most home growers in North America will be on 110 to 120 volts, whereas in Europe, the norm is 220 to 240. Commercial growers sometimes use three-phase power at 277 volts. 240 is more efficient than 110, but you must be sure that you have the correct power cord. In North America, the 240-volt cord is sometimes sold separately, and the 110-volt is included as standard, so be sure to ask to make sure that you have the right one. Number 2, what sort of lamp do you need? Back in the day, you had to buy separate ballasts for HPS and metal halide lamps, or buy conversion lamps to use one with the other. Your modern-day e-ballast should run both metal halide and HPS. The Galaxy Grow Amp will run metal halide single-ended HPS and double-ended HPS lamps, all at super high frequency, over 100 kHz. The Hortolux Platinum Ballast and the Diva by Revolution Micro take a different approach and run the aforementioned lamps using a low-frequency square wave. This is handy as they can run the new double-ended cmh lamps too. Also note that you can now run de-hps lamps on magnetics. I'm talking about the new Sun Systems Hardcore Ballast, which is proving very popular right now. But anyway, back to electronic ballasts. Number 3, noise. Not that kind of noise. I'm talking about electromagnetic interference here, or EMI, produced by poorly designed e-ballasts. The EMI can also be so bad that sometimes it interferes with your cable and Wi-Fi and or your neighbors. Not good. In fact, most e-ballasts only conform to FCC Article 18 Part A, which sets maximum emissions for industrial use. A better target is FCC Article 18 Part B, which governs consumer electronics but has far more rigid and harder to meet standards. The only e-ballasts that I'm aware that do this are Sun System 1DE Galaxy Grow Amp and the Diva by Revolution Micro, which, by the way, also meets FCC Article 15 Part B. Number 4, can it run different wattage lamps? Most e-ballasts come with a watt selector feature so that you can drive any lamps up to 1000. Some have a power boost or turbo feature that allows 1000 watts to be overdriven to 1150 watts, but I'm not a big fan of this as it shortens up the lamp life significantly. While these features may seem appealing, especially when expressing in watts rather than percentage, I prefer to run my lamps on ballasts rated precisely for the wattage. Sure, a dim or an auto-dim facility is handy if your grow room becomes too hot, but don't dim metal halide lamps as it ruins the spectrum. If you think you're going to use the dimming feature, be sure that your e-ballast is smart enough to automatically ignite at full power even if it's set to run in dim mode. Number 5, cable length. I'm talking about the cable between the light and the ballast here. Sometimes the standard 6-foot cable between your ballast and grow light won't suffice. Pay a little extra for 12 feet instead. Number 6, circuit breakers and mechanisms to avoid hot restrikes. A circuit breaker should ideally be built into the e-ballast and be smart enough to automatically wait before restriking the lamp that's just gone off, perhaps due to a power cut to avoid damage. Number 7, socket and fixture compatibility. Many e-ballast manufacturers have proprietary cables and sockets that work exclusively with their own brand of lighting fixtures, so be mindful of this when making your choice. Number 8, lighting controller compatibility. Some e-ballasts and integrated lighting fixtures can be connected to a remote electronic controller box via telephone cables. For small home growers, this may be overkill and you're better off going with a regular relay such as the Helio series, but if you're planning something larger than a 10 lighter, then it's definitely something to consider. Okay, I missed cooling mechanisms and some other deeper stuff that we can cover in follow-up videos. You could also avoid having to buy an external ballast at all by opting for a plug-and-play integrated lighting fixture. Anyway, I hope some of this was useful and not a waste of your precious time. One final point. According to my YouTube statistics, there's an 85% chance that you're watching this and somehow not yet a subscriber to my channel. This is deeply irksome to me, people. After all, you can watch my videos for free, and subscribing is free too. So for the love of all that is good and right in this world, hit that big red button and show me some love. Don't worry, I won't call. I won't even text. And I won't even turn up at your kid's birthday party dressed up like a clown. I will simply stay right here at a mandated safe distance and continue making these videos. But you must subscribe. That's the deal. Thanks for watching. This is Everest, switching off.